In this season, you choose to perform Endmit Violin Concerto. Can I ask you why you choose this piece in particular for this season?
Mm-hmm. There are many concertos and recital works that I get to play this season, of which Hindemith is one.
Yes.
And Hindemith actually is celebrating its anniversary in 2013. So it is Hindemith's anniversary year as well. And what is particularly interesting about this year that Hindemith wrote this violin concerto is that, well, he wrote it in 1938-39, and this is the same year that the Bartok Second Concerto was written, the Britten Violin Concerto was written, I believe the Berg was also written this year, and the Walton. It's just so many different violin concertos of such different styles written, and really gives an insight. It makes one start to think about the diversity of the musical styles, the diversity of the languages that these composers had.
Yes, this was a very particular moment in the history of Europe, I mean, and actually the world, because of the Second World War just starting, and taking that historical context in consideration, does make you have a different approach to the concerto, the context in what it was written?
I think every music that I get to play, music itself for me, the way I feel it, the way I hear it, the way I think about it, the way I interpret, it is really a combination of everything, of awareness, of emotional response, of historical insight, and so many different experiences that one doesn't even notice, but is definitely being taken in by the person somehow unconsciously. And so therefore, in that sense, I have to say that the historical awareness of this particular time in history for Europe and the world, as you say, cannot be separated from the way I hear the music or the way I interpret the music. It is not a conscious effort to try to make some connection with historical elements and to make it particularly sound as if it's relevant to a particular incident or an event that happened within the context of history with certain elements of the concerto in this particular.
Yes.
Work, but as I said, it's difficult to separate completely, because what you know, you can't totally ignore.
Yes. Do you feel, would you describe this concerto in terms of emotion, emotions, within a particular mood, the Endmit concerto?
I think like all other great works that we have in the canon, there is a variety of emotions. I think Hindemith is often perhaps, you know, described as being very, very romantic or pseudo-romantic. Also, what he does with a form, with a craftsmanship of all the details of compositional technique. These are things that people often talk about Hindemith.
Yes. In this particular concerto, do you have a favorite moment as a performer, like a special movement, or you know, these moments that are more deeply felt or in the concerto?
It's difficult to say, because so much of it is really, you know, in the context of everything else. I love the piece. I
yes.
really, really enjoy playing the piece.
Yeah.
I love the sound of it. I love the humor in it. I love the depth of feeling that comes with it. It's very special.
Yeah. With such a busy schedule in your career, you find time to dedicate to educational programs. How do you find time for that? And
I always like to say that it's not me finding the time, but it's more that time finds me. Yes. And I don't particularly separate my career into different pockets of activities, from being involved in educational work or being a performer with orchestras or in recitals, and the teaching that I do at the university, working with young aspiring violinists. I don't separate any of them. They are all together as one, and they all work together as one. They all influence each other, they inspire each other, and they keep me motivated about every single activity that I'm engaged in at any given point.
And I guess that is not a recent feature of your career, because our guest concertmaster, he remembers vividly the master class you gave in his school in China. So I guess, how did you come so early in your career in these educational programs?
In terms of working with children, young children, and bringing music to them and giving them the opportunity to have general music education, I formally started this work in 1992 with the establishment of my first nonprofit organization in New York, Midori and Friends. And subsequently, I went on to start two other organizations, Partners in Performance and Music Sharing. Music Sharing is the one in Japan. Partners in Performance and Midori and Friends are in the US. All are still going on very strong.
Oh.
All with its own mission. It's all, you know, it's all doing very, very good work. And it's really to bring people together, but particularly children, and giving them access to the knowledge of music. I've been teaching violin at the collegiate level, university and graduate school, for a long time, I guess over 10 years now.
Yes.
And I enjoy it very much as well. I enjoy the administrative responsibilities that come with being the strings department chair at USC Thornton School. And also having my own core group of students of 10, and master classes in different conservatories and music schools. I've been giving this for 20 years. Everything really is, for me, inspiring and enjoyable. And it was a very natural outcome, I think, of the family approach to education, to society, to community. And I didn't think that I was doing anything different when I started to get involved in education.
Yeah. Well, I just have one last question, and that is about your violin, the violin we are listening tonight. Can you tell me something about your violin?
My violin was made in 1734 by Granarius de Vigesu, and it was made in Cremona. It's nicknamed Ex Hubermann because it was the violin that belonged to the violinist Bronislaw Hubermann. Previous to my playing on it, it was for many years in the hands of Ruggero Ricci.
Right. So I'm very close friends, I guess, you and the violin. Well, thank you very much for
thank
your
you.
Presence here. It's a great honor.
Thank you.